when you're sure you've had enough of this life, hang on. Don't let yourself go. Cause everybody hurts.
Good. Hi everybody, this is Dr. Ed Park from Recharge Biomedical, and we're doing a webinar today on Polymyalgia Rheumatica, or PMR. PMR stands for poly, many, myalgia, muscles hurting, just like neuralgia is nerves hurting, arthralgia is joints hurting. So it's many joints. Polymyalgia Rheumatica means something with the joints, like rheumatoid arthritis. So PMR is a pretty clever name of saying many muscles hurt, but it's a joint disease. So they haven't learned much about this condition, and it's a really interesting quote-unquote disease, but let's go through the symptoms that are common. Typically, you would have aches or pains in the shoulders experienced in the large muscles, like the deltoid muscle, the shoulder muscle. The neck hurts, the lower back, the buttocks, hips, and thighs. There's terrible stiffness, especially in the morning, and then as you start moving, most of the joints or the muscles get better. The range of motion is affected, and there's inflammation of these joints. In addition, you have usually you can have a low-grade fever in the early part of the disease, as well as nonspecific symptoms such as fatigue, weight loss, depression possibly being secondary. What's typical for this condition is that it affects the proximal joints near the axial skeleton, the shoulders and the hips, but the knees and the elbows, wrists, ankles are spared. So what causes this? It's really unknown what causes it. It's thought based on the pathology that it's an antigen or some cross-reaction. What we see empirically is that the T cells, which are the coordinators of the cellular immune system and the other immune system with the antibodies, the plasma system, there tends to be macrophage activation, which means that these little garbage trucks that going around, these amoebas that swallow up the bad packages, they are swallowing something up, and they cluster into these giant cells, which are kind of clusters of used amoeba killers called macrophages. Interestingly, if you go back in the literature, some people are doing muscle biopsies because the muscles hurt. But in point of fact, this is referred pain from the joints. It's actually the joints are inflamed, and it just feels like muscle pain. If you do functional analysis on the muscles, they're normal. So it's just referred pain from the joints. There's no vasculitis, meaning arterial damage, although over the long term, atherosclerosis, meaning damage to the inside of the arteries, can ensue, and that's just because of the general inflammation going around the system. A related disorder is called giant cell or temporal artery arteritis. On the right is one of these giant cells that I mentioned. One cell, one nucleus, but here we have a giant cell with many nuclei. So these are like, each one of these started out life as a little amoeba garbage disposal killer. And as they got activated and excited, they all joined together, sort of like, let's say, droplets of oil merging. And so they became one big droplet. The reason we mentioned giant cell or temporal arteritis is that 50% of people with giant cell arteritis or temporal arteritis have PMR. Now, the inverse is not true. Only 15% of people with PMR present with giant cell arteritis. This disease is typically characterized by pain in the temporal arteries, both sides, and they can be nodular and tender. In addition, there's scalp pain where the distribution of arterial blood flow is. This person actually has some sloughing of his scalp as a result. The carotid artery is what comes up from the neck, the subclavian artery, I think, and it feeds everything above the neck. So the internal carotid is spared, going to the brain, the circle of Willis, but the external carotid branches feed the face, and including the jaw. So you get this terrible jaw claudication, which feels like kind of a rotten eye tooth. The artery itself, as I mentioned, is tender, and typically the most worrisome symptom is you can get ischemia of the retinal artery, and in 15%, it can actually result in permanent blindness. If we look at the epidemiology and the treatment and the prognosis, interestingly, it's a sudden onset in most cases. Half the cases, it's a sudden onset. And of course, when you do retrospective history, the patients are often not good historians, as we'll see in the testimonial from our patient later. In fact, there's been clusters of outbreaks. Some people have suggested there's a cyclicity of 7 or 8 years, suggesting it could be like a seasonal cold or flu virus that helps contribute. It typically is 2-to-1 predilection for women over men, and Caucasians have a higher disposition, going north, the Scandinavians being the highest, and the lower Mediterranean being lower. The diagnosis is made by detecting inflammation in the system generally, which can be done with the ESR, the erythrocyte sedimentation rate, or the CRP, the C-reactive protein, both nonspecific indications of inflammation. Also, when you treat somebody with steroids, because treatment is steroids, if they respond within 2 weeks, you know that was probably it. If they don't respond, you might have to question that diagnosis. As you may or may not know, a corticosteroid is like prednisone. It's given for things like really bad asthma, immune disorders like lupus, and we'll discuss that a little bit, but that's the only treatment we have. We don't know what's causing it, and we don't know how to treat it, so we just generally blunt the immune system. The prognosis for giant cell arteritis is relatively good if you don't go blind initially, whereas for PMR, it's guarded. It tends to persist. You need to be on high-dose steroids, and once you taper off, you get a high rate of recurrence. So depending on whether you think that's a cure or not, generally speaking, you're not completely rid of disease, as stopping the steroid treatment will cause a relapse. So what on earth could be causing this symptom? Well, as usual, we go around and we try and infer from the time course, the people that get affected, biochemical studies. It's really impossible at this point to say. What we do know is that it tends to be sudden onset. Again, there are clusters, almost like outbreaks, but there have been multiple suggested microbes, ranging from chlamydia, mycoplasma, parvovirus B19, so-called Fisk disease in children, adenovirus, and parainfluenza virus. And all of these, I guess, in general, they can affect joints. So it's interesting that there isn't one specific agent. One thing that we've talked about in the past is that autoimmune and viral and idiopathic, meaning we don't know what causes it, are all kind of synonymous. And they joked about this in 20 years ago in medical school. But it's true. When doctors don't know what's causing it, we just call it autoimmune, viral, or idiopathic. In point of fact, this is kind of idiotic to suggest. I mean, we do know that some viruses can cause changes in the immune system, by incorporation or by other methods, by gene expression. And now we're starting to understand there's even diseases caused by prions, which are not even viruses, but just little protein packets, which questions the definition of what exactly life is. One classic prion disease would be Jakob-Creutzfeldt disease or mad cow disease. But the point is, people say, and you know, even the patient we interviewed said this is an autoimmune disease. Autoimmune is not really a useful term unless you're talking about the classics such as lupus, rheumatoid arthritis, where there is an identifiable antibody which is attacking the self. So there isn't really a detectable monoclonal antibody. There isn't one specific antibody that we can think of. as with, again, lupus, rheumatoid arthritis, some of the other things like Sjogren's syndrome, scleroderma. Autoimmune is, again, a wastebasket term, and I believe it just represents dysregulation, cellular dysregulation, immune dysregulation, something about the way the cells are talking to each other and recognizing each other as self or friendly or diseased is wrong. And we need to probably get away from that term autoimmune, because it implies that treatment is immune suppression, which, again, if we had the precise tools to fix what was wrong, then that would be much preferred than just a blanket shutdown with steroids. And another thing that's interesting is that PMR tends to be age-related. It's very rare before the age of 50. And so unlike some of the other collagen vascular diseases like lupus, which can occur much earlier, there seems to be an age-related component, suggesting in my mind that there is a component of aging cells, replicative senescence. This is meant facetiously when I say elementary, my dear Watson, because, you know, in looking at this, looking at all the causes that have been suggested, to my mind, nothing jumps out. And that's why we're all experts in PMR now, because the literature just is non-existent on this. People have tried to guess, and everything's negative. And basically, it's just saying, well, should we use steroids to treat it, or should we use something else? Nobody has any good ideas. They've looked at receptors for T cells, nothing. Again, there's no one agent. You know, one thing they looked at was parainfluenza virus, which is a virus causing one of these flus. And IgM, which is an indicator of recent infection, is twice that incidence, 40% versus 20%, in people who, in a case-controlled study, which is admittedly not the best kind of study. So that may be a partial component. There's also case reports of PMR-like syndrome after administration of dipyramidol, which is one of these one of these inhibitors like aspirin or ibuprofen, and it also blocks uptake of adenosine, which is needed for energy in the red blood cells and, more importantly, the vascular endothelial cells, the cells lining the arteries. I don't know what that has to do with there's been case reports of similar symptoms with minoxidil and enalapril, an ACE inhibitor, and these both have an effect of increasing blood flow. Also, there have been gammopathies such as Waldenstrom's, macroglobulinemia. Anemia. There are certain diseases where the IgG is overproduced, and it's been reported to cause similar PMR symptoms after vaccination. And so this is really a hodgepodge, not suggesting any clear a single etiology. So it could be something that is like Parkinson's, as I argued in webinar 20, I believe, that Parkinson's is not even a disease. It's a description of the signs and symptoms that can be caused by many different factors. It's possible that the joints and the arteries share some kind of antigen that's being released or attacked. So if we don't know what causes this, let's think about the age-related component. And this comes from a webinar I did on obesity, I believe. And what it's meant to indicate is that at the core of all age-related diseases, meaning diseases that get more prevalent as we age, is this concept of replicative senescence. Replicative senescence means that as cells copy, each time they copy, they need to replace the lost length on the ends of their telomeres. So the cells that are quite good at this are called stem cells. They have telomerase, which is actively lengthening. As each time they divide, they need to shorten mechanically, just because you can't get the primer to the very edge. So it is probably a pretty robust and sufficient explanation for a lot of diseases that the cells, in particular stem cells, age. When they get too short, as indicated by here, this fuse that has gotten too short, the chromosome will become damaged. And then when cells are damaged, they can't faithfully reproduce. Sometimes they can't kill themselves, though. So this outer, I guess you would call it octagon, is apoptosis. So when cells get damaged, you know, very, very commonly, and the central role is to kill themselves, if they don't kill themselves and they remain there making copies of their damaged cells, we get all these manifestations in the arteries. We could get high blood pressure, atherosclerosis, macular degeneration in the retina, failed immune system, and in particular, we'll do a show on one of these nonspecific myelodysplastic syndrome. Again, I would suggest that that's just a failure of the stem cells that make the blood cells. Stem cells, generally speaking, that are damaged by replicative senescence can cause every form of cancer, and that's borne out in every study that's been done. Shorter telomeres, higher risk of cancer. And when connective tissue is damaged, you get wrinkles, osteoporosis, arthritis. In the gonads, you get menopause, andropause, beta cells, diabetes, brain, Alzheimer's. So again, people focus on the disease. They work back to a single cure as if it's like polio, but actually polio and the infectious diseases are relatively poor models for what we face as we get older in a modern industrialized society. And one could argue that replicative senescence could be at the heart of all these age-related disorders. One thing that is a problem with taking steroids, as anybody will know, and if you see JFK, he had Addison's disease, which is a failure of his pituitary, and so they supplemented him with cortisol, and his face got really from very handsome young to moon-faced as he got older. Certainly the stress of the office wasn't a factor, but the face will get very round, and diabetes is common as well. The glucose tolerance is impaired. The skin doesn't heal. It gets bruised. They can get stretch marks and hyperpigmentation also, which is very unpleasant. You also can retain fluid and get obese, and the blood pressure tends to be higher. Another cause is another sequelae or consequence is osteoporosis from both the poor absorption of calcium and the inhibition of the cells that produce new bone, among other things. The muscles will waste over time. Glaucoma can happen, and there's irritation of the stomach leading to ulcers. And of course, when you suppress the immune system, you have an increase in opportunity infections. So at this point, I'd like to listen to, I think she's 76-year-old gal. She found out about us and TA65 through a blog, and she decided to give it a try. Very interesting lady. She is into holistic things, somewhat mistrustful of the medical establishment from her experience with PMR in her mother. And this, again, bears out the fact that there may be a genetic predilection because she had cared for her mother 30 years prior when she was in her 40s. And the minute she was told the same thing that her mother had been told, she realized that an alternative was needed. So she did reflexology, some kind of biological healing, stuff that's kind of beyond me. But she did get a modicum of help, but her disease had begun about 14 months prior and was really all-consuming and still quite debilitating. So let's listen to what she has to say.
So you have PMR and temporal arteritis. What are your symptoms?
Well, better said, what were they? Inability to sleep well. I would wake up with about every 90 minutes or 120 minutes.
Right.
2 hours and a half, but never sleeping through the night.
Yes.
And it's from my elbows to the shoulders up into the neck, and the legs from the knees up into the thighs.
Okay. And how many years has that been? Has it been constant or better at times?
It started in December of 2010, and it's been and it was awful. It was just horrible, crippling, and I have my husband to take care of. So it was, and the pain was constant. And I did take some ibuprofen for about 8 or 9 days, but it took so many to relieve the pain that I realized that would be not a good thing.
What were the symptoms of your arteritis, may I ask?
Well, in my head. Very tender places in my head.
Were there visual signs? Or
visual.
Problems with your vision?
Yes, I had some vision. Yes is the answer to that.
Okay.
Extreme pain in my upper arms and upper legs, 24/7. I mean, every time I woke up, every conscious waking minute, I was in extreme pain.
Oh.
It was miserable.
Yeah.
Depressing, to put it mildly.
When did you notice any difference?
Right away.
So the first morning you woke up, you felt a little better.
Well, but you see, I don't sleep all night.
Okay.
I have not. I was sleeping a lot better sometimes. You know, I'd sleep maybe 5 hours or something. The first night I took it, I woke up in about an hour, and I woke up again in about an hour, and then I slept for about 5 hours.
Oh, good.
And I did have some dream that I remembered maybe the second night. And just, you know, it's possible that it was right after I took the TA-65, and I went in a week ago last Friday, so maybe that was even the first day. And I feel pretty good. I was feeling pretty good before, and I'm feeling better now.
Like mood-wise, energy-wise, you mean?
Both.
Yeah, good.
My husband is dying.
Oh, my God. Okay, so?
He's 93 years old,
uh-huh.
And he's here at home. And I have some help here, not around the clock or anything. So nights are very difficult, and last night, fortunately, I you know, with the TA-65, I took it about 8:45, and I went to sleep right away. And I think I woke up once very briefly, and then I slept until about 2:30 when he woke up, and he's so very agitated, saying, I have to get to the other side of the room, and trying to get out of bed, and just totally agitated. And I think the other side is not the room, but anyway. Anyway, it was a very long night, and this morning he'd not had a bowel movement in 3 days, so in spite of all the things that I've given him. So this morning, I spent 4 hours. Finally, he did, and I got him up and down 5 times. So anyway, I finally ate something for the first time a few minutes ago. Anyway, so on some levels, it's a very difficult time for me. However, I will say that I woke up this morning. Then I slept between about 4:30 and. And then I've been up since a little after six. But I did get up with a feeling of well-being, so that's pretty amazing, considering I'm almost 76, so that's...
And it's a stressful time for you, too.
Very stressful. Well, the good news that I'm so happy to report is that basically my PMR is a thing of the past. I don't have any pain. I don't even... Think about it. There was a period when I almost missed it, or, you know, it was there for so long, and it was funny not having it there. I'd stand up, and it didn't hurt. Anyway, that passed. And it's wonderful, because I never took any steroids or any medication from of any sort for it, and I lived with it in huge amounts of pain for about a year until I began taking these pills, the TA-65.
Yeah.
Only occasionally do I have sort of very vivid dreams that I did not particularly ever have before. Consistently, though, my sleep, which was terrible, and I have to say that it did take a few months before I got to where I am now. I mean, I still had disrupted sleep until, I don't know, perhaps the last maybe three weeks or so.
Yeah.
I now go to sleep and about the same time every night, about 10 o'clock, sometimes a little earlier, sometimes a little later, but basically around 10, 10:15, and usually wake up sometime. I don't even open my eyes. I don't stay awake maybe more than, I don't think, a minute or two. And I go right back to sleep, and when I wake up, it's 6:30, something like that. And it is now. If anything, it might be maybe 15 or 30 minutes less than I typically had before. But whatever it is, I wake up and I know I've had all the sleep I need.
Yeah, so you feel ready to go.
Yeah.
Now, when you wake up briefly in the evening or during the night, is it a long, like a 1 minute, less than a minute type of deal?
Yeah, it's very short.
Yeah.
I'm aware that I wake up. I'm aware that I don't want to open my eyes.
Yeah.
You know, for a while I did wake up and stayed awake longer, or maybe did get up to use the bathroom, but I didn't have the ability to read or anything. And now I just sleep all night.
That's
great.
I
wake up just very briefly.
That's great.
And maybe one time out of 10 or something, I might get up to use the bathroom. Oh, I didn't. I had terrible sleep. I couldn't go to sleep. I couldn't stay asleep. I slept in a chair for about 10 months because
I couldn't
get out of bed.
So you didn't have any pain medication, though, right?
No, I did. When I first started, I took what's a common ibuprofen.
Yeah.
I had never taken it in my life, and I took... But it took so many, and they told me to take it around the clock, that I, after about 9 or 10 days, realized that I was going to ruin, I was just going to have more problems. So that was the beginning and the end of pain medication.
Wow. So you just toughed it out.
It was really bad.
Yeah. How bad was it for your mom?
My mother went the other route. She took huge doses of prednisone,
mm-hmm.
and ultimately... You know, she got a lot better, but she was totally prednisone dependent, and I, over time, she developed all of the symptoms pretty much that you read about.
So, like weight gain and
pain
suppression.
Stretch
marks.
Osteoporosis.
Diabetes.
Yeah, she for the first time in her life she craved sugar.
Mm-hmm.
After a while she was really that's mostly what she wanted to eat was sugar.
Mm.
That was what she just. So if you read a list of things that can happen when you take prednisone over long periods of time, basically she qualified for most of them.
So she had high blood pressure.
Yeah.
Did she get pigmentation, like hyperpigmentation?
Yes, she did, which was disfiguring, and she hated it.
Wow.
And so she went to a doctor constantly. I mean, she went to more than one doctor. She had this doctor and that doctor, and she had glaucoma, and I don't know. Anyway.
So you feel kind of like you dodged a bullet. You saw what it was to take the normal medicine then.
Well, I think what probably was the game changer for me was that was maybe 30 years ago when she went blind, and within 48 hours she lost the vision in one eye because that's where the temporal arteritis struck.
Oh, my God.
And so, you know, she did everything the doctor said. But I took her to the doctors then, and I listened to them tell her that she'd have to take the large doses in the beginning, and after 2 or 3 years, she might get off of be able to get rid of the prednisone. And when I went to doctors 30 years later, lo and behold, they said the same thing. And one doctor did finally admit to me that they hadn't made much progress in that area.
So that's good. When did the pain go away, like mostly or completely? Was it gradual?
Most, it's been quite gradual.
Gradual. Okay.
Very, very, very gradual. And it's only, and I think it's been since I've been really sleeping so well, a lot of things just sort of improved.
It's about 3 weeks ago, maybe?
But there was a huge progress prior to that.
When did you notice, did you notice right off the bat that you were feeling better?
Maybe after...
2 weeks?
Two or three months. It took a while before I really began to notice significant difference.
Yeah, usually people turn the corner about 3 months, don't they?
I don't know, but I would say that's... And so I took the first one of these... The first day that I took this was on October 6th.
Yeah.
And so today is February 14th.
So about 4 months. So right about 3.5 months, 3 months is when you really started. Yeah, that's pretty typical for most processes. So very, very happy. So you're pain-free now.
Pretty much. I don't. Days go by and I don't even think about it.
So that was that was our patient. Obviously very happy with her condition. Really going through a very stressful time with her husband passing away. And you just have to remark that, you know, she's even on the night or two before her husband passed, she was waking up with a sense of well-being. I think most people who've cared for a loved one would say that's not typical. I mean, the mind is just racing, and it's hard to get any kind of sleep. And I believe it's not a coincidence that a lot of partners get cancer a year or two after treating for a dying loved one because the stress is killing all the cells and not and interfering with the sleep, and you're not repairing those telomeres. So that concludes our PMR discussion. I'd like to open it up to questions. If anybody has a question, you can certainly type it in the bar below the white lower left side, the meeting chat. You can also call in by hitting the button in the middle right. I guess my final conclusion is that it could be caused by many, since it's caused by many different things, there is a genetic susceptibility profile. It could be that it's just a kind of stable, damaged T-cell genotype slash phenotype. The T-cells get damaged in such a way that they allow for the attack of self-antigens, and the antigens that would be shared by the arteries and the joints might be some form of collagen or elastin. But again, total speculation based on the available circumstantial evidence. Let's see here. We have questions. We have a question from Trevor. Have you had any patients with fibromyalgia take TA65? If so, have they seen positive changes? Yes, I have had a patient, and it did, I think, go away rather quickly. Fibromyalgia is a related topic, but this is much more of a somatoform, or I wouldn't say, you know, it's more of a non-physical, somewhat psychological problem. So it's not, I wouldn't say psychosomatic, but we call them somatoform, meaning that mood and one's mental state highly influence that. And fibromyalgia is characterized by sore points all over, everything hurts. But again, that may have a supratentorial or a brain component. Mary asked, has TA65 been used with any autistic children? Not that I know of. I've had people ask me about that, but it seems awful, you know, a lot of money to fix something that is primarily a growth and differentiation issue. So one of the theories surrounding autism is that it is not a failure of growth, but a failure of pruning. As the brain develops in late gestation and in the early infancy, the brain propagates extensively, and then it needs to be pruned back and killed off by selective apoptosis of a functional nature. So it's like trimming a bonsai tree. If you just get growth without the proper cell death, you got a bush, and that's not good. And so the kids are unable to process certain things of language and social skills. And so, again, autism is the classic example of not a disease. It's a description, and there are many ways to become, quote-unquote, autistic. So, sadly, you know, a lot of the advocacy groups come at it with, like, oh, you know, it's got to be the power wires, the vaccination. There is no one disease called autism. It's just a very poorly defined functional category saying, well, they have some kind of pervasive language difficulty. Well, that's not really a disease, is it? But I think the problem with autism would be that the cells have already differentiated, and I don't know that you can really knock them off and cause them to redifferentiate. Cells that are terminally differentiated in higher organisms, and I use that term loosely, don't tend to de-differentiate. An exception would be if you cut off my leg, it won't grow back. If you cut off a salamander's leg, it will grow back, or a tail, for example. So there are certain programs that can be turned on to go back to an earlier dedifferentiated state and regrow stuff, but it generally is shut off. So I don't think autism would be that amenable to cure. Michael, to everyone, I missed the first 10 minutes of the seminar. Is there a definitive test for PMR? No problem. So there is not a definitive test for PMR. They do a SED rate, or to check if there's inflammation in your blood, with these two tests, ESR and C-reactive protein, and it's empirical. If you treat it with steroids and it gets better, then probably it was PMR. But you don't need to have no fancy stuff to know what it is. It's you got some sore shoulders and hips. That's it. It's PMR. And if it's associated with temporal arteritis, as it often is, as 15% of the time it is, then that's what it is. It's not a hard diagnosis to make, just a hard one to cure. Jeff Apodaca asks, do you have a theory on how TA65 influences sleep? Yes, I do. And that was a nice thing that came out in her testimonial, was that sleep is are meant to be cycles of 90 minutes, 4 to 6 of them a night. So, of course, if you have disrupted sleep, as in the case of sleep apnea, your consciousness is always being awoken by suffocation. And so you never really go to the normal, you know, sort of Orpheus-like state. You go down into this kind of paralyzed state of delta wave, slow wave sleep. Your body is completely paralyzed, which is why if you've ever been woken, you can have night terrors. You feel like you can't move. So this is when the body, the growth hormone, is surging in the first two cycles, and all the cells are reproducing. In the last two or three cycles, it's more of a brain thing, isn't it? So you're making 10,000 new brain cells, and what's going on there is that you're laying down the tracks of a new memory, and you take in all the experiences of the day, and your attitudes, your feelings, your hopes, your neuroses, and you're actually killing off sectors of your brain and reorganizing them. And so it's the short answer is your cells copy more efficiently. So what does that mean? It means that because you need to copy 10,000 new nerve cells to make the new memories in the process of procedural dreaming, then telomerase is the rate limiting step. Every time you copy a cell, it needs to cap off the tips of the chromosomes. The telomerase activity is so high that's happening faster. And so you dream faster, it's more colorful, more vivid. These are some of the most common and specific complaints or reports of taking TA65, I would say, is that the dreaming is more vivid. And as a subset of that, the content draws from very strange subjects. It can be more colorful, people describe. Some people describe lucid dreaming, or the opposite, not being aware that they're dreaming and thinking it's an alternate reality. So this is a very striking, albeit quite subjective, trait of taking TA65. And to answer your question, it's because the cells are copying faster. So you go from like an old TRS-80 computer or 386, and then you bump up to some kind of faster chip. And so I think that's what's going on. And so both physically, mentally, eventually spiritually, you get better off in terms of your sleep and your rest. And that comes through the testimony of the patient. So I think that's how it influences sleep. And as everyone knows, the key to longevity is sleep, right? And a sense of humor. There's only two things that have been positively associated with living a long time. One, I think, is sleep, but you can't sleep if you're not, you know, healthy, if you're in chronic pain, if people are dropping off and around you and you have stress and morbid preoccupation with death, you know. So what our patient describes is an upward spiral. You know, even though her husband was passing, there was a calmness and acceptance of that, and now she's looking forward to a new phase for her life, you know, running for public office. And so another common nice trait is when you take this stuff and you really start to feel better, for whatever reason, the upward spiral takes over, and the phrase that people use is looking forward. So some people are looking forward to playing the best golf of their life. Some people are looking forward to becoming students in Italy, looking forward to a lot of different things. So it's a change. Any other questions? Susan asks, should you stop all supplements while on TH65, such as fish oils, B12, CoQ, MSM? I do not claim to be an expert in these things. I want to get Dr. Dave on, who is kind of an expert in fish oil. And one of the things that I didn't have time to put into this testimonial was the fact that our patient had been taking green mussel oil, like mussels on the barnacles type of deal, and she felt that that was helping quite a bit, although she did have the chronic pain up until starting the TA65. As far as CoQ10, B12, there is evidence, melisalamine, I think that's what that is. Again, I am not an expert. I love the testimony from last week's webinar on addiction, because one of the clients mentioned that as an experiment, he went off everything. He was a supplement junkie, so he felt like that was a way of really isolating the role of the TA. And certainly cost-wise, I think it's great to go off everything because you can afford more TA. I mean, she was only taking two capsules, and she had a pretty dramatic result, even you could argue after the first night. And so part of what I wanted to draw attention to was the subjectivity. I mean, she maybe stopped for a while and restart, that we really understand and compare and contrast what it is with and without TA65. So I did see that question, and it does, Mary asks, does a person regress quickly after they stop taking TA65? There are three levels on which TA65 works, I believe. The first is the nightly sleep level. So if you don't take it one night, apart from the physical repair that's happened in your brain, and that comes out in podcast we did on twins, that part of dreaming is that your brain is damaged. It's not going to dream well. The procedure, there's something wrong with the computer. So they both started, twins both started dreaming around 3-4 months, which again is kind of the corner that people turn. So that's the first level. If I don't take it tonight, I'm going to wake up not rested, not with a feeling of well-being. So that's the first problem or symptom. The second is inducible cells such as skin, intestines, nails, immune cells. These are inducible to an extent for telomerase, so they do get healthier slowly. You know, if you stop abruptly or if stop at all, they will gradually start to age, but there's never any sudden withdrawal or anything like that, which we talk about in the addiction webinar. And then finally, the long-term benefits are paradoxically both immediate and cumulative. What I mean by that is, you know, as crazy as it sounds, a lot of what people experience is sort of a baffling overnight resolution of some symptoms. And to me, that represents the death of certain cells. And so, for example, this person might say, oh, my shoulder was aching so bad. My Achilles was hurting a lot right after I started taking this. But now it's fine. So basically, I believe that those cells are able to go through a final stage of apoptosis. It's kind of like when you have the gym shorts and the little string that pulls from one end to the other, or a hoodie sweatshirt. Even if you have a little nub, a knot at the end, you know, sometimes the nub gets pulled in and you got to sneak it out somehow. The telomeres are just handles for the chromosomes. So perhaps activating the telomerase allows you to get that final string nub out, and so you can do what you need to do to kill that cell. And the inflammation that ensues is typically, I believe, the body clearing that debris. And then over the course of time, you know, perhaps the 3-4 month mark is how long it takes for the existing copies of those damaged cells to go through their Hayflick limit and actually die off. So it's all conjecture on my part, but that's why we keep on listening to patients and trying to piece together the puzzle. Clinical medicine is derived from observation, but sometimes it can be misleading, as in the case of Parkinson's. This also may not be typical of a quote-unquote disease. in the classic infectious, although there are characteristics that are kind of infectious in nature. So I'm sure they'll figure it out someday. And I just think that in terms of, she's a very insightful lady, and she quickly identified that, the doctors really didn't have a lot to give 30 years ago, likewise here. And that really comes out in a very heartbreaking way with the brain cancer call that I had a couple of days ago. And this gentleman was just running up against all these doctors, had this core value of hopelessness, as we discussed in the recent webinar on cancer in TA. And so his anecdote is he had like 5 or 6 points of contact with medical doctors, experts, and they had this idea like, you're going to die, but let me do this to you. Oh, and I can't believe you let that other doctor do that to you. That never works. But then again, mine never works. And, it's kind of a cynicism and a glibness that is a defense for us practitioners. But when you're shuttling your loved one through the system, and they say to you with a straight face that, I want to poison you, and you're still going to die, and why are you still alive? These kind of things are quite grotesque. And so, he is a very sad story, and I think a lot of people feel bullied, and hopefully going forward, it's certainly not easy to be out there alone against the establishment, but when the establishment is offering nothing but despair and torture, sometimes it is good. And that's not to say that all treatments are created equal. I mean, going down to get Laetrile, like, Steve McQueen, or maybe Steve Jobs going to get his funky shaman treatments, not all treatments are created equal. But certainly, I think the idea is out there that if a drug company is not profiting from it, there might be a lot of stuff that is active or helpful. And sadly, a lot of this is the blind leading the blind, but there might be things out there that could be helpful, alternative and complementary. So,
I just wanted to tell you that, I was taking just one capsule lately, but it's still, I am amazed about the deep sleep, and sometimes I process, I had a dream when I was like 4 years old in my old house, my parents' house in Hungary, and in the dream I was kind of hurt because my mother wouldn't let me wear the dress I wanted to wear.
No.
And I remember this, and how I carried that thing in my subconscious until now, and that it was kind of such a big release after this dream. It just amazes me how it brings back, really, really childhood stuff that, you forget about it, or I forget about it.
It's so interesting, isn't it? I mean, they say when you lose your mind at Alzheimer's, you remember vivid things from the remote past, but I think that our consciousness really is made up of these brief moments, of childhood,
uh-huh.
And there's things are just so much different than we would imagine them in terms of our experience subjectively.
Mm-hmm.
So things that are emotionally charged go so deep, and they become part of our firmament, our constellation. And so what is remarkable is that people comment, they'll say, oh, I dreamt about a dream, or I thought about this dream I had 40 years ago, and it was so real. It's because those moments of that mental state is like a Polaroid. It just is indelibly there. And when you clean out the closet with this functional cleaning out of the brain, the defragmenting, these things just come out of the closet, and they're real entities. They have a whole life of their own, and it's just fun to see them come out, and all the skeletons come out and start dancing. It's interesting. On the flip side, if you have a lot of anxiety, sleeping can be quite a, it can be exhausting if you have a lot going on in your life. I know so there are times when I dread going to sleep because I know it's going to be a, north by northwest type of plane thing happening.
Yeah. Oh, I have a question. I was in an auto accident about a year ago, and pretty bad concussion. and a sense, or
oh
more
gosh.
Than a year ago, 2 years ago, and I really realized my memory is very, you know, I just don't have the memory that I used to have. So is that something, beginning of Alzheimer's, and then would this TA65 help to not to get it, or what would that
be? I don't know. That's a great question. We'll have to see, but you know, TA65 is not treatment for anything. But I did. We did have a very interesting guy in Australia talk to us about his traumatic brain injury. He had a horrible, horrible traumatic brain injury, and he seemed to have a huge, huge improvement in his ability to interact socially and to process speech. And so that's another future webinar we might do. But concussion falls into the broader category of traumatic brain injury. And, of course, you know, the brain is an organ that can heal. So I don't know. I think that Alzheimer's, though, is more of a cellular damage problem. And again, I would highly suspect that that's from copying those cells too many times.
Mm-hmm. But is the,
you
is
don't
the
have Alzheimer's. I've spent time with you. You're not Alzheimer's.
Yeah, every time I think of it, when I can't find my keys, well, my God.
No,
maybe I have.
You told, oh, that's not Alzheimer's. That's just keys. But when you told that wonderful joke, will you tell us that joke about the Russian scientist? And his,
Oh, yeah.
Will you tell a joke? Let's end with a joke. This was such a depressing webinar.
And
okay,
that was,
it's all
that
yours,
was like before they discovered the TA65. So in Russia, one of the scientists who was sent to Siberia discovered a molecule that actually, if they would put it in a water, bath water, and you were sitting in it for an hour or two, then the person was getting younger. So he gets a big award. Now he can visit his mother in Moscow, whom he hasn't seen for 40 years. And he's very excited, and all the news talks about him, and he comes down from an airplane, and he sees a wonderful young woman there with a baby on her arm. And he says, "Oh, Mom, oh, I'm so glad you got younger also from my pills. And who is this baby?" He says, and the mom said, "Oh, your stupid father fell asleep in the bathtub."